Come on. send forth sentiments as soon as possible. But we thank you from the bottom of our hearts for all that was done on yesterday and the day before. Amen. We just thank you for your prayers. Continue to pray for us. Continue to pray for us. Amen. I didn't think I was going to be here this morning, but the Lord said otherwise. So, amen. We're here, but we have a guest speaker on this morning, the Reverend Charles Williams. Amen. He's going to bless us on today. I'll let him introduce his wife, who is no stranger to us. Amen. Since he came and got her from us. Amen. We're not going to stay here too long. Amen. But we're glad to have him to help us out on today. And we just want to have a good time with the Lord. Amen. We want to have a good time with the Lord. We want to look at, again, thankful to all of our listeners, those who are here today, and to all of our, again, Facebook listeners and free conference call. We just thank you for supporting our ministry. If you'd like to continue to partner with us, again, you may do so safely and securely through our website, gntbckc.org, through PushPay and our Cash app. Again, we thank you. God has been good. In spite of ourselves, God has been good. And we're just so thankful. Thankful we are thankful. So our response to reading on today, Psalm 119:105. Thy word is
a lamp to my feet and a light to my path.
And our vision model, pouring oil for the lamps of men to light the world. Amen. We just thank God. Amen. We believe that it's the word of God that is the oil for our lamps. He said, keep your lamps trimmed and burning, amen, as we spread the word of God, as we evangelize, as we continue to just put the word of God out there, amen. That's what helped us to navigate through this world, amen. It's the word of God, amen. So we thank God for you, and we're going to, again, have our music ministry to come in whatever way, and after that, the next one you'll hear is the Reverend Charles Williams, amen. God bless you, God keep you. Give him a hearty amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Our special guest from Tacoma, Washington. She's no stranger here. This is my eldest daughter, my only daughter. Nicole Eileen. Any female she's running to that's a rain dog, she's got to check them out. She want to make sure she's the only sister. God bless you.
Can I do a 23 and me? I'm like, nope. Ain't no more. Good morning. We're just going to, can we worship together just for a second? And we're going to worship God. And go eat. Amen.
All right.
It's always good to be in the house of the Lord. Always good. This is the day the Lord has made. And we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Praise the Lord. I greet you from the Peace Baptist Church located at 2300 Chestnut. Former pastor is Gary Lee. I am the associate minister there, C.O. Williams Jr. And also we have an evangelist, percussion. Praise God. Saints, continue to live. Works wonders.
Amen.
Works wonders. And we all know I am the Father is the comforter of all comforters. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. I'd like to acknowledge my wife, Valerie, if you would stand. She's the earthly love of my life.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise and worship your holy and your righteous name. Please give each of us the mindset of Christ. We look to the hills which come to thy help. And thy help cometh from the Lord. Our prayer is you open eyes to see and perceive, ears to hear, and every heart to understand. With each departing with a different godly perspective, speak in me and through me your unadulterated word, that your word be heard and not now. We ask it all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, and for his sake, amen.
Amen.
If you would stand for the scripture, please. Our subject matter is coming from the epistle of Philippians, 4th chapter, verses 6 and 7. That's Philippians, 4th chapter, verses 6 and 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, Lord, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You may be seated. Today I will be speaking to you on a subject regarding anxiety. Familiar? It's arduous and it's hindering consequences. which does affect all that has a heartbeat. That's everybody. We'll also be covering the actions needed to do away with these consequences. A subject no one wishes to associate with. Luke Rawls was a popular singer back in the day. And he had a title that was applicable. More so now than it was then. And the title of the song was, we're living in a world of trouble. A world of trouble. A pretty short thought. Paul addresses the Philippians, which was his first founded church, which he and Silas was in prison. During which, and this he encountered beings, and there was no compassion on him, all because of casting out an evil spirit of a fortune telling slave girl. They brought him a lot of money, a lot of property, and this. In doing so, enraged her owners. Paul had several, he had several purposes in composing this text. First, he wanted to express through writing, and his writing to his thanks to the Philippians for their gift. He wanted the Philippians to know why he returned the appetites, and that he was a benefit to him, but he wanted people to know that. Third, he wanted to inform them of his circumstances at Rome. Fourth, he wanted to disarm them to unity. Fifth, he wanted to warn them against, and we got a lot of this going on now, but got people that's called false teachers. All right, finally, he wanted to warn them, and I exhort them to not be weary in well doing.
Right.
I'll get back on them. Becoming weary will bring about anxiety. Amen? No matter who we are, life will inevitably attempt to bring fear, stress, and worry to ravage our lives. Which are in these scriptures that we'll be coming from today? Overcoming an anxious mind. Saints, Paul is neither advising or recommending. He is commanding. Because of the vitality of profoundness of his instructions, which are simple, yet essential and necessary. Now, it's different translations. That word, understanding, that word is translated by worry, by stress, which really means the same thing. Scripture tells us though. He said, without getting, get an understanding.
All right.
Don't be anxious about anything. Its origin may be initiated by the following situations, which are circumstances which we all find ourselves. They're dealing with facts and conditions connected with or relevant to an event or action. Anxiety, which is initiated by problems, which are situations that are unsatisfactory and causes difficulty for all of us. It's usually through an event or action. Anxiety is initiated by problems, which is situations that are unsatisfactory. We're speaking on this word here. Worry. Worry is a state of uncertainty. The ultimate byproduct of anxiety. What is anxiety? Now some of you may not be aware of this, but let the truth be told. Anxiety is an emotional disorder. I'm speaking to you today about one of our biggest struggles. Anxiety is a thief. It can steal our thoughts. It can steal our peace. It steals our confidence and steals our joy. And this epistle that is overridden with joy by Paul. Oh, it's expressed it throughout. At some point, we have to deal with the worry and all the anxiety. For many years, a woman couldn't sleep because she worried that her home would be broken into by burglar. It was just a thought that led her thinking for a long time, day after day, week after week, month after month, for a number of years. She had been playing out. Well, one evening, she and her husband heard a noise downstairs. Her husband got up and went downstairs to see what was going on. When he got down, he seen, guess what? It was a burglar. And he said something that was unusual to him. When he saw the burglar, he said to him, "Could you come upstairs and meet my wife? She's been waiting 10 years to meet you." The point is simple. A burglar can steal from you once, but the burglar of anxiety can steal from you for decades and decades. Now, it's sort of humorous to me as to what we as Americans worry about. What concerns us? What stresses us out? We put filters on our faucets. We put ionizers throughout our home. We level ourselves with antibacterial soap. We get worried about avian flu. We get worried about all kind of insignificant things. And at the same time, 20% of adults smoke. Ouch. 20% of drivers don't wear seat belts. And it's estimated that 75% of those that own a mobile device, I think some of them be agreeing with me here, they text while they're driving. All right. Anxiety is the most common mental problem in America. And it has been discovered 40. That's 40 million sufferers identified with some form of anxiety. 18% for American adults. In 2015, a little bit here, Boston University reported that anxiety now has surpassed depression and all other disorders in our country. Then they found out something terribly interesting. They took 14 countries around the world and studied them. The World Mental Health Survey said, Americans are the most anxious in the 14 countries that they studied, which has a significant clinical significant level of anxiety. More so than Nigeria, Lebanon, and UK. Now, if you know anything about those countries, you know those are trouble spots. And then what that tells us is the United States is the undisputed champion of anxiety and worry. We win the Olympics when it comes to anxiety and worry. Did you know over the last 30 years, anxiety disorders have increased over 1,200%? That's a lot. It's amazing. Lord help us. Are those things consume us? It's possible, praise God, to find rest for our souls. Praise the Lord. Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. Are among the most verses treasured by Christians because of their power to help overcome anxiety. One psychiatrist, Albert Leahy, he noted the average high school student today has the same level of anxiety as the average psychiatric back in the 1950s. That's amazing. I hope by now you're wondering, what are we so worried about in America? Why are we so anxious? I won't get into a lot of different factors, but we'll cover some of the top. One of which is the concern about the violence in America. Lord help. I mean, it's more violence today as the world turns. We're concerned about personal income. Will we have enough money for whatever should happen in the future? We're concerned about Social Security system, which also ties into the first. We're concerned about terrorist attacks. We're concerned about our healthcare availability in the future. And finally, we're concerned about racial discrimination. On one hand, I want to say I understand. From the perspective of a believer, looking at the unbelieving world, I get it. I understand why their anxiety is so high. I understand why they panic and why they are anxious. Listen carefully. If you don't live with an anchor of faith, you're going to drift into the sea of anxiety. Most people in the quote world, most people in the world are going down the wrong road. I spoke earlier. People that are So if you just think you're dangling in some capable universe with no explanation to be explained, no mind, no reason, no design, no plan, no God, and we are only there because of chance, you're sadly mistaken. You're sadly. We're still speaking on anxiety, which can be very lonely, very scary place to be. If you don't know why you're here and where you're going, that's scary. To be scary is to incorporate f.e.a.r, fear. False evidence appearing real. Three pertinent reasons we as believers should not worry or be anxious for nothing. One, because it's unhealthy. Two, because it is unbecoming. Three, because it's unproductive. Anxiety is unhealthy. Because when we are deeply agitated, which causes you to not eat or sleep, guess what? You will die. Here's an example. King Darius signed a decree when he was so stressed over what he had signed that it says that his sleep went from him. Neither did he eat or drink. That's in Daniel chapter 6. Look at King David, Psalm 6. Turned to God and said, I'm weary with my groaning. But all night I make my bed swim. I dread my couch. Tears. That's depression and anxiety. And there's Moses. Moses' prayer. He prayed, he said, my burdens are so heavy, and they're too heavy for me. Please kill me here and now. Beloved, that's anxiety. When you're praying like that, it also brings about many other chronic health conditions and complications. Second reason Jesus gives is unbecoming. It's unbecoming as a child of God. It's not fitting for a child of God. For a child of God to always be anxious and always worry and affect his sin. I don't trust you, God. You did say some pretty cool things that made me feel good, but then I went on and did my thing. So to be consumed with worry and anxiety is a betrayal of trust in the God Almighty that is caring for us. So to be consumed with it is a thought that wouldn't the care will lead you to what the main point of this verses are about. The Lord says, here's why it's so unbecoming. Hear me. Look at the birds of the air. They don't reap and they don't sow or gather into barns. But our Heavenly Father feeds them. Mark that language. He didn't say their Heavenly Father feeds them. He said, our Heavenly Father feeds them. Your Father feeds them with what? Bird brains? That has bird brains? If your Father feeds birds, then your Father's going to feed his children. But there's a relationship. It's unhealthy. And it's unhealthy and it's unbecoming. And the third is the reason is because it's unproductive. This affects a lot of us. Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to a session? Adding one cubit to the stature probably refers to longevity. Worry is fuel and cannot prolong your life. Let the truth be told. Worry will more than likely shorten your life. Now, let's focus on the enlightened parts of 6 and 7. In everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God will surpass all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. All we need to do is His word, the rock of our foundation, and that thinking, the thoughts that we shouldn't be thinking, it was the past because we know what the Lord tells us. He's got us, and regardless of the situation or the circumstance or the condition, we need to not be concerned about it. Praise God. Saints, the antidote or remedy for anxiety is delighting in the Lord. Yeah. Meditating on His word. Staying connected in humble prayer. Showing gratitude to God. Just as Paul stated, be grateful in all things. Because we serve the Almighty God that can do anything but fail. Oh, he's everything. He's the creator and sustainer. Earth and heaven. He's the way. He's the truth. He is the light. He's the Alpha and He is the Omega. He's our ever-flowing spring that never runs dry. Praise God, He's our Redeemer, our Provider, our Healer, our bright and morning star. He's the way out of no way. He is our comfort and praise the Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. He's our Savior. Oh, take your burdens to the foot of the cross and leave them there. He is the only one that can give us the peace that surpasses all understanding. I can't praise Him enough. I can't praise Him enough. I think by the way, you probably feel more. I feel like Jeremiah. I just want to shout the tears and tell the world that I serve. My God. I'm going to close this meeting to a close. It's still some days. A man was in a hurry to catch a plane. He ran huffing and puffing down toward the gate. He passed a guy who was dressed like with a pilot's uniform on. The guy said to the breathless man, "Where are you in a hurry to?" "Oh," said the man, "I'm late for my plane." He proceeded to tell the guy what the plane he was hurrying to. The uniform man said, "Don't be in a hurry. I am piloting that plane. Now, if the pilot is chilling, you chill too. Don't stress yourself out about things unnecessary. Wait on God. Trust Him. He's taking His time. We can too. Patience is a virtue. Obey God and let Him help the consequences." Saints, now we know what we should do in overcoming an anxious mind. Proverbs 3:5 tells us, and it makes it perfectly clear, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. Woo, Lord. But in all your ways, my God, acknowledge Him, and He shall correct your path. Now, if that's not coming, something wrong with you. I'm telling you, praise God. Because He is the world. He has the whole world in His hands. His hands. It's all about Him. And when we trust in Him, we ain't gonna worry about tomorrow. What they say, because tomorrow has enough problems of its own. Praise God. He's our burden bearer. To know Him is to love Him. God bless you.
God bless you. Amen.
This is a solemn decision to accept the Lord and follow Him in whatever we do, say, or go. Is there one that is willing to do that? Is there one that may have renew the relationship with the Lord God Almighty?
Yes, Lord.
Do you hear?
When I think about the Lord, how He saved me, how He raised me, how He filled me with the Holy Ghost, how He healed me to be a
yeah.
How He takes my
the streets. It's a good one.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. more prosperous and healthy birthday. So we're just grandma, you. Then Michelle, she's Michelle. So I know it's on Michelle.
Michelle's here.
Amen. Amen. She all the way from Texas. Olivia's daughter, God bless you. God bless you. Amen. For those who have traveled near and far. And again, we want to thank the kitchen committee, the hospitality committee, the benevolence committee, and all of you all that we've done in the last couple of days. We really thank you from the bottom of our heart. All the contributions made, the food, the fellowship, the love. We just thank you all for all you've done. Amen. Amen. So we're so grateful. We're so grateful. Brother Joe McCain, Ms. Aaron, God bless you. We see you back there. Amen. And his family. Amen. God bless you. Brother Q, we see you, brother. We hope you come back and see us again. Amen. Amen. So we want to, Sister Valerie, God bless you. Amen. Come back anytime. This is your home. Amen. All right. Amen.
Dana.
So we want to see who else we're missing on here today.
Dana. Amen. Back there.
I'm sorry?
Dana. Can you see her?
She's back. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Grew up in Gethsemane. Amen. 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 Your grandmother is yes, there. Great grandmother. Which one was it? Amen.
Grand.
Okay. Don't push her. All right. God bless you. God bless all of you once again. Continue to pray for me. We'll pray for you. So Paul has it clear, we're going to read what we traditionally read in 1 Corinthians 11th chapter to prepare our hearts for communion. Again, we find these words. Again, I'm reading from the NIV. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, that he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread, excuse me, and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. Amen. We're going to stop there. May the Lord have blessed the reading, hearers, and doers of his holy word. We believe that what makes us unworthy is unconfessed sins. So we bow our heads right now in silent prayer, asking the Lord to search our hearts and forgive us of our sins, to make us worthy to partake in the Lord's Supper. Eternal God and Father, we come once again with bowed heads and humble hearts. I'm asking you to come and ask you to approach your throne to search our hearts, forgive us of our sins, our transgressions. Lord, things we've done in thought, word, and deed. Lord, we ask for forgiveness right now. Lord, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. And Father God, not only sins of commission, but sins of omission. If we neglected what we should be doing, Lord, we just ask you to forgive us right now. Lord, make us worthy of these elements, Lord. We ask that you change them from a natural to a spiritual use. In Jesus' name, we do pray.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
The officers will come to prepare the table. Fellowship with you. Thank you.
Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, oh my soul. come to the closing of the worship. We pray that our worship has been pleasing in that sight. Lord, we thank you for the word that has been given to us on today. Lord, help us to be anxious for nothing. Bless our speaker, Father God. And may he continue to grow rich in your word, Father God. Now to give us able to keep us from falling to present us before the Almighty God. Lord, we just thank you and pray you that you leave this place, dismiss us, but never from your presence. Now may the grace of God, sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest and rule and abide with us, henceforth now and forevermore. And all God's people say,
and forgive us.